Lord, the words to that song just speak so loudly of who you are. You are more precious than silver, more precious than gold. You are our everything. And we come this morning just so thankful that we can be here together. We know we're kind of small this morning, but that's okay. We're family. We're together because we want to be. We're together because we've come to celebrate being family in you. And so, Lord, we just invite you to sit among us, to guide us, to help us to understand the issues of our lives today, to help us be aware of your will for our lives and for our church. Lord, we give you praise because we know that wherever two or more are gathered, you are there among us. And for that, we give you praise. And we thank you for all the ways that you make yourself known to us. We lift up our praise. We lift up our love. In Jesus' name. Amen. How about if we stand and sing a couple of praise songs this morning? We'll start with Gentle Shepherd. Is the family of God. That an usher would come forward at this time for our morning offering. Thank you. Father, we thank you for all the wonderful things you do in our lives. We thank you for all that you provide. We bring these gifts and offerings and lay them before you this morning with hearts that are full, because we know that we don't have anything on our own. We only have because you bless us, and we feel so blessed. So thank you. Thank you for your love. Thank you for all that you provide. Thank you for this church and for the warmth we feel from each person here. We give you our praise. In Jesus' name, amen. God been doing in your life this week? He's not on vacation. So you got to think about it a little bit. Becky.
We have a neighbor that lives across our pond, and she is a true help to us. We never thought we'd be in this situation, but we
get there, don't we? Yeah.
And she is such a help to us.
Good.
No, you know, nothing for her.
Yep. Well, other than she gets to be with people that are wonderful people too. So don't forget that. So, yes.
And Matt came to see me.
Yes.
Before a week or so.
Awesome. Good. Welcome, Amanda.
I'm healed from all the fractures.
That's amazing that she's doing this. I just think that's great.
I've been cast for 15 weeks from the
PM. Wow.
So,
isn't there? When you stop and think about our bodies, how wonderful they are. Mm-hmm. Yep. Susan.
I had Eleanor to call me 2 different times to tell me she knew somebody that could take care of my trees if they needed to be.
Awesome.
And also Norm Fick is still doing it. And I wanted to say I have some wonderful friends that are helping me out right now with some issues.
Good.
Yes.
Good.
Yes.
Good. That's a wonderful time.
That uplifts me big time.
Good. Okay. Anybody else? Money.
A concern.
Okay.
Jay and Wendy are still having problems with the COVID.
Okay.
You know, it's been like 3 or 4 weeks.
It's time for them to get over it and get better, isn't it? Yes. Yes. Other prayer concerns, other issues? I know we have a celebration for a birthday today. What? Grandma's birthday. 90th birthday, wow.
And they're also celebrating grandmother's 70th wedding anniversary.
Wow,
so
amazing.
Yeah. They're assembling.
Getting everything last minute ready. Yep, awesome. That is just a praise when you stop and think about being able to have them with you this long. And terrific, good. Anything else?
I dropped a heavy cake. It's not broken.
Shattered
toenail.
Oh, great.
Toenail.
Oh, yeah.
It's kind of an awkward wound to have.
Doing a lot of barefoot right now.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, ow. Yeah. Ooh. That makes me painful just thinking about it. Any other prayer? Yes.
A couple concerns. The neighbor I was just talking about, her sister-in-law, they found that she has breast cancer. Her name is Tammy.
Tammy?
Tammy.
With a T or a K?
A T-A-M-I.
Oh, okay.
And then our close neighbor beside us, Lillian, is 90 years old, and she does really well. But she, right now she's having a really tough time. Her eyes are getting worse with macular degeneration.
Mm-hmm.
She's got back problems now, and then she had an ear infection that made her dizzy. So right now she's really going through a rough time, Lillian.
Okay. Tammy and Lillian. Okay. Rex?
Yeah, the people in the Ukraine are really taking a beating.
They are. Keep them lifted up. Others? Well, let's take a moment then and we'll just go to the Lord and just drop all of this heavy stuff on Him this morning and let Him deal with it. So, Lord, we do come this morning knowing that there's not a lot we can do for any of these situations that we've lifted up to you this morning, other than just to keep the people that we love before you. We know that Jay and Wendy have been dealing with the COVID and illness now for several weeks, and you know, we pray, Lord, that they would soon be able to put that behind them and begin to feel well again. We think about Jenny and her foot and how difficult it is to get around even with just a shattered toenail. And that makes us think about Amanda's fall and her wrists and her hands that have now healed pretty well, and we're really thankful for how you created our human body, that it can heal, it can find even new ways of working when we deal with an illness or an injury, and we can still go about our life in a pretty good fashion, and we thank you for all of that. We want to lift up Becky and Monty, their neighbors. They are so blessed to be in an area that people look out for one another. Not only does Tammy help them, but they too lift her up and her sister-in-law as they deal with issues of health. We thank God for Lillian and her 90 years of life. And we know that as we age, it becomes more difficult to just get around and to do the things we need to. And I'm sure that Jenny's grandma and grandpa, in their advanced age, feel those difficulties too. But yet, what a joy it is to be able to celebrate their life together and their advanced age. So we pray for their party this afternoon. We pray that neighbors and family and friends will be there to help honor them and celebrate them as they deserve. And Lord, we pray for Susan as she's kind of finding a new way to take care of herself and to see people that are willing to come alongside her and help. That's such a blessing, and we thank you for them. We ask, Lord, that you hear us this morning as we pray for our denomination and for our church. We are in a time of trying to discern what is your will for all of us. And so we ask that you make yourself known. guide us, direct us. Let us be as full of grace toward others as you are with us. And Lord, just gather us together as your children. Because we know that here in this place we are part of your family. And it is such a joy to be together. To find love and acceptance and grace and just fellowship. And so we ask this morning, Lord, that you hear us, especially as we join our voices and pray the way Jesus taught his disciples to pray, saying, our next hymn is scripture. It comes right straight from Psalms. So I'd like for us to sing it, and then I'm going to read it to you. So, thy word is a lamp unto my feet. So do you know what part of that song is right straight from Scripture? Can you put the words back up a minute, guys? Let them look at it for a second. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Now I will not forget your love for me, and yet my heart forever is wandering. Is there more words? Jesus, be my guide. Hold me to your side, and I will love you to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Say that part with me. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. There, you just memorized a piece of scripture, because I bet you could say that again. That comes right directly from our psalm this morning, Psalm 119. We'll be looking at verses 97 through 106. Do you know Psalm 119 is the longest chapter in the Bible? little bit of trivia. Do you know one of the verses, and I can't tell you which one, in 1:19, is the center of the Old Testament? Do you know that too? That's just trivia. Doesn't have anything to do with anything. So. All right. Beginning with verse 97. Oh, how I love your law. All day long, it's my meditation. Your commandments make me wiser than my enemies, for they are always with me. I have more insight than all my teachers, for your testimonies are my meditation. I discern more than the elders, for I obey your precepts. I have kept my feet from every evil path, that I may keep your word. I have not departed from your ordinances, for you yourself have taught me. How sweet are your words to my taste, sweeter than honey in my mouth. I gain understanding from your precepts, therefore I hate every false way. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. I have sworn and confirmed that I will keep your righteous judgments. I am severely afflicted, O Lord. Revive me through your word. The word of God for the people of God. Praise be to God. You know, I think everybody that comes to church knows that we're supposed to read the Bible. But the fact is, many church-going people, they don't. They just don't read it. And I've kind of tried to figure out why. I've asked, you know, why not? How come you're not reading the Bible? And I get a variety of excuses. Some people just tell me it's boring. Some people say, well, I can't get anything out of it. I just don't understand it. I'm too busy to sit down and just really read and think about it and study. So those are just a few of the statements that people say when they don't read the Bible. But I think it's funny. You never hear people say, yes, I read the Bible every day, and it's boring. You don't hear them say that. Because once you start reading, once you start meditating and thinking about what you're reading, that Bible becomes so interesting, so compelling, that you really can't just stop. I believe with all my heart that we as Christians are supposed to be reading our Bibles. And I think there are a lot of reasons, good reasons, why we should. I think that scripture reading is being really overlooked a lot. And it's a shame because right now we probably have more ways that we can read the Bible than any other. I got almost all the way here this morning and realized I'd not picked up my Bible because I still like that physical book in my hand. I really, when I read, I like a Bible. But I've got a Bible on my phone, and that's a good thing too, because I hardly ever forget my phone anymore. I usually have it with me. So if I have a few minutes, if I'm sitting in a doctor's office or waiting at a railroad crossing and like over here on Scott Road, where you get to wait for hours and hours sometimes. You get a lot of reading done if you've got your Bible with you. So, I think it's an important part of being a Christian, and I think it's being neglected a lot today, and that's a shame. In fact, I really think that the lack of reading our Bibles has helped bring us to the point we are at with our Methodist denomination right now, because there's a group of leaders in our denomination that feel like scripture is not as important as others feel that it is. They have decided to set scripture aside and to not follow it as the inspired word of God. And that makes me sad, because I guess all of my adult life, ever since, well, even as a child going to Bible school, that was the place, that Bible was the place that I was sure I could find truth and I could find answers. And as I've gotten older, I have even come to that understanding more so. If I truly believe that every problem, every question that human beings come up with in our everyday life can be answered in Scripture. If we read, if we study, if we know where to find the answer. So I'm going to give you some reasons why I feel like all of us, every one of us, need to get into our Bibles. And especially right now, because I feel like that's where we'll find the answer to the conundrum we're in as a denomination, is within God's Word. So sometime while you're sitting there, you may want to, I just saw a gentleman in the back there taking a picture of that screenshot. And you may want to do that if you have your phone with you. If you don't, get your pencil out. You might want to write some of these scriptures down. I'll give you that warning so you've got time to do it. I'll talk about them in a little bit. How many of you have ever seen the movie Oh God with George Burns? Did you see that? I mean, it's been a long time ago now. But one of the questions that movie brought up was, do you suppose God is anything like he was portrayed in that movie? Well, you know, that's a hard question to answer. And seeing that movie probably gave you a whole different take on what God might be like. But if you really want to know what God is like, you can find out. The Bible tells us exactly who God is, exactly what he's all about. So that's the very first reason why we need to spend more time reading our Bibles. If you have depended on pastors over your lifetime being giving you information about God, you have a very limited knowledge. I'm going to tell you. You have a very limited knowledge of who God is, because he is so much bigger than any pastor can give you information about him. There are some pastors that try to make you believe that God is more concerned with maybe saving whales than he is saving souls. Or they tend to help make you think that he's not, his primary concern is not about forgiving you, that maybe his primary concern is punishing you instead for your sins. And so, for you to know who God is, you have to do some digging and finding out on your own, not taking somebody else's word for who they think he is. So, that's the first thing. You have all the tools you need in your Bible to get to know God better. The second thing that I think studying or reading your Bible a lot will help you do is it will help you find solutions for problems. The Bible's not just full of cute Bible school stories that are fun to teach the kids about. The Bible talks about real world everyday problems and challenges and how to live through them. So get to digging, because you never know when a problem's going to pop up in your life, and you're going to wish you knew where to find the answer to how to find it. I had a friend that he had a teenage son, and like happens so often in families, as that teenager got a little older, the father began to feel like there was tension between the two of them. The kid would clam up every time dad would try to have any kind of conversation with him, or he'd disappear to his room, and the father was really concerned. And one day when he was reading scripture, he came across this piece of scripture in Ephesians. It says, don't keep on scolding and nagging your children, making them angry and resentful. He said it was just like, whoa, it jumped right off the page at him. He realized that that's exactly what he was doing to his son. You know, that there was hardly any conversation that didn't include some sort of criticism, like don't slouch, or can't you find any kind of better music to listen to than that, or if you want to go to college, you better get serious and study now. So he said, I decided that for 10 days, I would not say anything critical to my son. And he said, I was really careful about everything we talked about. And he said, at the end of that 10 days, I realized that it was not my son that was putting up a wall between us. It was me. It was my attitude. And he said, even now, we, as a grown man, not a teenager anymore, he said, we have developed a really strong relationship. And he said, I don't think that would have happened if I hadn't been reading my Bible and come across that one piece of scripture. What did Psalm 119, verse 105 say? Help me. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Think about that. Thy word, your word, Lord, is a lamp unto my feet. Everywhere I go, everything I do, it's just like your shining on my problems, on my life. And then helping me to find my way. The third thing that reading scripture does is it does help you find out when you're doing something wrong. I know a young man that when he was in college, he worked in a hospital, and he would go to work. He would do his work really fast, not very well, but fast. And then he would go hide in the closet and study his school lessons for a couple of hours every night. And he told me he found a piece of scripture in Colossians that says, whatever you do, work at it with all your heart, as if you were working for the Lord, not for man. And he said it just convicted him right there on the spot. He realized that he was cheating the hospital because they were paying him for 8 hours of work, and he was not working 8 hours, plus he was not doing a very good job when he did do their work. But he also realized that he was cheating God, too, that he was sinning against God. Hebrews 4:12 tells us, for whatever God says to us is full of power. It is sharper than the sharpest dagger, cutting swift and deep into our innermost thoughts and desires, with all their parts exposing us for what we really are. Now, some people hear that verse and they think, oh, great, that's just what I need. I feel guilty enough about sinning. Why would I want to read anything that points even more to what I'm doing? Well, there is a good reason. The Bible doesn't just beat us up for sinning. It also points us in the direction of forgiveness. You see, the Bible, sure, it does reveal our sins to us, but it also shows us how to be forgiven. Doesn't make us relive our guilt. It helps us relieve our guilt. It tells us how to find forgiveness and peace and joy and happiness and contentment. All of the things that most of us are really looking for. Hebrews 4:16 tells us, "Let us then approach the throne of grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need." The final thing that, not the final thing, but the fifth thing today that I'm going to talk about, that reading our Bible regularly does for us, is it helps us find comfort during times of crisis. You know, there are some problems that just can't be solved in our lives. Some problems, some situations, we just really have to endure. And that's where God tells us that He will walk right with us. He will not leave us alone to face anything. So, you know, whether it's an illness, whether it's the death of someone you love, or some kind of crisis, during those times, we can find comfort in God's Word. You know, prisoners of war in Vietnam brought back stories of how they had pieced together all the verses of Scripture that they could remember from when they were kids going to Bible school and stuff. And they made little booklets. They wrote it on toilet paper or cigarette wrappers or whatever they could find. And they made their own Bible comprised of Scripture that brought them comfort and peace. And for many of them, that was the only thing that got them through those horrible years of imprisonment. You know, passages like John 14, the 23rd Psalm, Romans 8, all of those offer comfort. You hear them used at funerals often, but you know what? There are hundreds of other verses that contain words of encouragement and hope that we can cling to during the difficult times in our lives. So, reading the Bible is not like reading a novel or a history book or even the newspaper. Something really supernatural happens when you read Scripture. The Holy Spirit speaks to you through those words. When we read our Bibles, we are connecting with the eternal in that moment. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Right now in the Methodist Church, we're kind of in the midst of a conundrum. Many of us are not sure what's going on that is creating this feeling of confusion and even disappointment. We wonder, how are we to go about being the church here in Arcola? Well, I believe the Bible gives us the answer to that question and to every question we might ask of it. So I want to challenge you to begin reading specific scriptures, scriptures that teach about what the church is meant to do. Why God created this thing that we call church. I've listed a few scripture up on the screen. That's just a few of those that are in there. Do any of you know what a concordance is? You have one in the back of your Bible. Okay, almost every Bible has one. And in that concordance, not only does it tell you what the word means, but it tells you where it's used in Scripture, in your Bible, so that you can read for yourself and make sure that you understand what it means, that you won't don't get a confused misunderstanding. So I want you this week to look in your Bible for the word church. And I want you to start reading all of the different scriptures that deal with church. Like I say, I just took a few from my Bible. The Luke 4:16, that talks about worship. You know, why we come together as a church. One of the very first reasons is because it gives us opportunity to worship. Acts 12:3-5 talks about the importance of a church's prayer life. Revelation 2:5 talks about how love in community plays out. Ephesians 4:12-13 talk about the responsibility of being in the church. 1 Timothy 5:9-16, 2 Timothy 4:1-12 admonish us to make sure we're preaching and teaching the gospel, the good news about Jesus. Hebrews 10:25 talks about the importance of fellowship in community, in church, why that's such an important thing for us. You see, God has, he had something in mind for us as the church. And I think we're, as a denomination, we're kind of getting off the path. And so one thing we can do as parishioners, as Christians, is we can be sure that we are interpreting Scripture as he would have us to. But you have to read it first in order to do that. You can't take what Terry and I tell you every Sunday as the gospel. Let me tell you, we are human. But you can have the Holy Spirit help you read and understand for yourself what the Bible's saying. So that's your homework for this week. I want you to read it, and you remember, you can't read it like it was a novel or even a newspaper article or history. You have to be asking questions. And three really important questions to ask whenever you read Scripture is, what does this Scripture tell me about God? What does this Scripture tell me about mankind? Or me, if you want it to be really personal. And then ask, what does it tell me, what does it teach me about the relationship between man, God, mankind and God, or yourself and God? And seek the answers when you're reading Scripture to those three really important questions. I think we'll all be able to find a sense of peace in the midst of the confusion that we're living in right now as United Methodists. If we find the answers to the questions that we each have in our own hearts. So, get at your homework. It's not a free week this week. You got to work. Would you pray with me? Oh, Lord, just help us. Show us through your word exactly what you want for us. How do we go forward as your church? What do we do in order to be the best representation of Jesus to our community and to those of our friends and family that watch us? We want to give a good witness of your love, and that means we must be obedient to your call on our lives as disciples. Sometimes that seems kind of hard. So we ask, we ask for your guidance. Speak to us through your word as you lead us. We are seeking, and Scripture tells us when we do that, when we seek, we will find. Amen. Let's stand and join together in our closing hymn this morning, Wonderful Words of Life. As you go this week, go in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and find His word for you. Amen.